Good evening, everyone. We're going to begin. If I am going to try and stay close to the microphone and speak as loudly as I possibly can, but as the night gets longer, you're going to find I'm going to sit back and you probably won't be able to hear me that well, which may be incentive to wrap this up early. I'm not sure. But in any event, tonight is a public forum, and we're going to talk a little bit about the MBTA lease. Specifically, what we're going to go over, it's not dissimilar from our meeting earlier in the month, well, actually it's March, early in February, where we talked about where we stand with respect to the process, what are some of the things that are still left to do, and then we can answer some questions that you may have. Tonight is for us as much as it is for all of you, so that we can again listen to some of the concerns and make sure that as we go through this process, we address them. So I'm going to begin just with a summary, a very high-level summary of where we are today in connection with the MBTA lease. So as you all know, at town meeting, the selectmen were authorized to negotiate with the MBTA and to bring back a lease to town meeting to be voted on. With this process, we began with the form of lease that is already available to us. And we felt that that was a really good place for us to start. Again, the lease is primarily for the rail trail, and we also wanted to be able to accept gifts or grants for this purpose. Next slide. So on February 16th, 2017, the Board of Selectmen at our meeting voted to ask the MBTA to approve the lease form that we have negotiated. That lease is on the town website. We took the original form of lease from the MBTA and we redlined the changes that we have asked for. And we're not going to go into detail as to what those changes were, as we are assuming that everybody here has actually gone onto the website. We also instructed the town council to advise the Board of Selectmen of any changes before town meeting, and we asked the MBTA to arrive at a mutually acceptable access license for us to present to the town at town meeting. We submitted this document to the MBTA, and on February the 24th, I'm two slides ahead, we actually were fortunate enough to have a conference call with the MBTA's consultant. And at that point during the call, what we really wanted to make sure that the MBTA understood was that we wanted to be able to bring to town meeting a lease that was as close to a final form as it could possibly be. The MBTA consultant, somewhat to my surprise, I'm not sure if the surprise of others, felt that that was a realistic goal for us to have, and he felt that they would be able to expedite the changes that we requested through the MBTA. Of course, there are no guarantees that this will happen, but we are cautiously optimistic that we will be able to bring a lease close to the final form of a lease to town meeting to be voted on. One of the comments that the MBTA did make was they felt that this was possible because we did start from the form of lease that they had and did not try to start from a blank sheet of paper negotiating each and every one of the terms. And we really have Steve Anderson to thank for that approach. So we are optimistic. We want to convey to everybody and make sure that you all understand that this is a give and take process. You know, we have asked for changes to the lease over the next couple of months. We are going to be hopefully talking to the MBTA, some of the changes they may allow, some of the changes we may get, some of them we won't. We will continue to post what we can on the website to keep all the citizens of Dover and ourselves current as to where we stand. But I can't emphasize enough that there are just no guarantees in this process, and we will bring what we can to town meeting, and we are trying as hard as we can to push the MBTA to move so that we do have an agreement that's substantively final by the time we get to town meeting. Again, just some of the principal changes that we requested. The premises that we were leasing was something that we heard loud and clear at town meeting, so we tried to get changes on that. The term of the lease, the rail removal, and how to return the premises upon termination of the lease. We also are trying to mitigate some of the liabilities, provisions such as those to third parties, the termination and rights of abandonment and injunction, and the environmental liabilities. As far as the lease premises, could you jump to the map? This is I tried to fit it all on one slide, so I apologize for the size of the map. But as you can see, that is the entire parcel. And what we have asked for in our lease is to lease from the south side of Hunt Drive through the north side of Dedham Street. And then we asked for an option to lease from Hunt Drive to the MBTA, to Medfield, and then on the other end, from the north side of Dedham Street to the Needham Bridge. So the way we approach this lease is we ask the MBTA to allow us to only lease this section of the lease, but we also ask for options to allow us at a later date, should we like, to lease the other two parcels of land. So we can jump back to this. Actually, you can go forward again because I've said all of that. The term of the lease was something else we asked the MBTA for allowances on. Rather than entering into a 99-year lease right off the bat, we asked them to break it up into four sections: 25 years with an option to extend, another 25 years with an option to extend, a third 25 years with an option to extend, and then the last portion would be 24 years. And again, the options to extend would be at the town's discretion. The next item we asked for was the rail removal. If the MBTA chooses to remove the rails, we're going to ask that they do that by a certain date. As I'm sure all of you are aware, there are financial benefits to being able to remove the rails yourself, because there are some there are proceeds that you can get from that. So if the town is responsible for the disposal, then we would like to get the revenue that we would be entitled to for that. We also asked the MBTA to execute any necessary bills of lading, manifests, or other forms required from the landowners reasonably necessary for such disposal. The open issue here is that on the termination or expiration of the lease, the MBTA wants us to return the grade to a certain grade. And so we have asked to understand what that is and also to see if maybe this requirement can be waived. I'm sure most of you have read this recreational facility, but Beals and Thomas does address restoring the grade in this. And one of the items that they do say in here is that the MBTA has never really pushed for anybody to restore it. So I do, over the weekend, I went back and read through this report, and all of you, I also asked the town administrator to put it on the front section of the website, and I really encourage all of you after this evening to go back and reread this document, because it really is extremely comprehensive and answers a lot of questions that I forgot were answered in the document. The other issue we asked for was third liabilities to third parties. And Council, maybe I'll have you go over this one.
Okay. Sorry for the loss. There are several users of the railroad right of way that pre-exist the town, and the lease potentially could put on the town liabilities associated with the third parties. And so we have asked to exclude the town's risk or liability with respect to those pre-existing third parties. We've asked for the MBTA to minimize any impact to the town's use from any future third parties, whatever it might be, some utility or whatever, and that if there is an existing lease or license that would prevent a continuous corridor within the leased premises, that the town would have the option, if it felt necessary, to terminate. So if we can't get the use that we think is important for us to have, and it's caused by the presence of a third party, then that's something that we are asking for the right to terminate on.
As far as limitation of liabilities, the town edits, incorporates limitations on liabilities under the Tort Claims Act of General Law 2.
Maybe you want me to
run with us, because these are...
Yeah, reciting the statutes and whatnot in the slide. So many of you may be aware that state and local governments enjoy certain protection from liability and certain caps on liability, and the lease had been silent on that. There are situations in which one could assume by contract something over and above the liability caps, so we wanted to make sure that that doesn't happen by stating expressly that the cap under the TCA, the Tort Claims Act, applies, and that the recreational use defense applies. So unless there's some sort of willful or wanting behavior, that the town has a defense to liability. There's also a defense for the individuals at the different parties, the board, the MBTA, and so on, who are involved in negotiating this, but that's the case under the DCA anyway. Let me know if you want me to keep going or stop.
Yeah, you can do that next one.
Next one, okay.
Sure.
The latter. We want to make sure that the absence of the term doesn't mean we're not entitled to it. So we've put it in. It's to our benefit. It's to their benefit. It just should be in there. It's not in the standard document. Okay. The next issue has to do with the question of abandonment of the railroad right-of-way and title issues and so on. We talked about this some the last time. Since that time, there's actually a new case out of the appeals court that affirms adjustment of the land court involving an MBTA railroad right-of-way, where there was a challenge brought by an abutter that owned land on both sides of the track to the validity of the T's title to the corridor. After a lengthy series of court cases, started in the land court, the T won summary judgment, went up to the appeals court, remanded to the land court, a trial was held, and the T won at the trial, essentially that the landowner was barred by the statute of limitations and by standing from trying to contest the T's title to that particular railroad right-of-way. And as I say, this case was handed down by the appeal group. I think it was very, very recently, February 23rd. It's actually still in the appeals period if they want to try to go up to the SJC. But for those of you who wonder about title issues, abandonment issues, that is a very recent development in favor of the MBTA, and by extension, in favor of a lease, should the town meeting approve the lease. The facts in that case were somewhat different than in this case. This case is actually a better set of facts. In that case, the trains last operated in 1938, here much more recently, and so on. There are a variety of factual situations here that are different from there. We have also, as we mentioned the last time, contacted the STB, the Surface Transportation Board in Washington, and they are functioning. They have people that answer the phones. They are looking into this issue for us on abandonment. They understand it is not an unusual request. They've asked for specific information on the railroad right-of-way. We've given a copy of the lease exhibit that you have up here, because it's the full length of the track from top to bottom in the town. And we also are providing the MBTA's deed, order of taking, the railroad right-of-way valuation maps, and so on, so they can orient themselves. They know that proving a negative is a, you know, an important and difficult thing to do, but they've done it before, and they're working with us on that issue. We are also contacting Mike Marsh, lawyers in the audience who do real estate work. Well, no, Mike, he does a lot of title work. He testified for the MBTA in their recent case that on title issues with respect to the railroad right-of-way, he knows more about title to railroad right-of-ways in the Commonwealth than most other examiners, and we're getting a cost estimate to run the title for this particular railroad right-of-way, consistent with the questions that were asked the last time. And we'll be working with the town and the friends on that being one component of due diligence.
And as far as environmental liabilities go, I would like to remind everybody that Town Council in 2016 prepared a memorandum for us that goes into detail regarding the environmental potential risk to the town. And tonight I'm going to go over this in very high level, but I do recommend to each of you to go onto the town website and download that memorandum. so that you can read it in a little more detail than what we're providing this evening. You know, certainly if you don't sign the lease, there's no exposure. However, if you do sign the lease, there is some exposure. It is unquantifiable. However, it can certainly be mitigated by the negotiation of lease terms, the statutory defenses, which is under 21E, is that correct? An environmental insurance program, and DEP best management practices. One of the things that Beals and Thomas did do and go over in the feasibility study was they did look at all the historic records that were available regarding how the rail trail in Dover was operated. We do know that there were no battery vaults along the proposed path and that there were two switches near Springdale. We also know from the other rail trails that have already been developed that typically what you do find are arsenic, lead, and PAHs. All of those contaminants, the remedy for that is containment. And the rail trail is containment. So you cover it up and you don't have access to it. And so I think it's important for everybody to understand that the rail trail is the preferred cleanup mechanism for railroad beds. One of the things that the town did ask for in the lease is we did ask the MBTA to clarify the language on operator, owner, and you can
see this is, again, you might want to turn to me on this one. So there are different defenses in 21E that relate to environmental liabilities, and we wanted to make it clear in the lease, again, with express language, that the town's obligations under the lease are subject to and without waiver of those defenses. And so there are three of them that are listed up here on the screen, but they have to do with a rail trail exception to being a status liability party, an eligible tenant exception, and defenses to liability for sort of innocent parties that are afforded by Section 5 of 21E. So we've said in the lease that our obligations are subject to those defenses. We've also included expressly the environmental insurance statute that creates certain protections from being forced to give an indemnity in the lease. So the T will not sign a lease without the indemnity in there, but the statute trumps the indemnity if you buy the environmental insurance policy, and that's what essentially is on offer here. As I explained the last time, there may be a situation in which the town does have to remediate something. For example, if it's a rail trail, it's in use, whatever, it's being maintained by a piece of equipment, a gas tank ruptures and releases gasoline into the groundwater, whatever, it would have to be taken care of. One of the tools that LSPs use to close out an environmental problem, whether it's a new one or a historic one, is an AUL, activity and use limitation, that essentially scopes the cleanup to the use that's being made. And if it's a transportation corridor, if it's a rail trail or whatever, it would not be restored necessarily to pristine condition because the corridor itself may have historic contamination there. Rather, it could be closed out with an AUL, putting everyone a notice in the registry that there was a situation here. If you have to work in this area, you have to observe appropriate protections, costs, and so on, but you don't have to dig to the center of the earth and take out whatever it's there to, you know, remediate the problem. problem. So again, that one's a, it's not in the standard lease that we would, by right under the contract, be able to use that. It would be discretionary by the MBTA because they would have to approve the approach the town took. So we are asking to build it in to something that we can in fact use without saying please. Okay?
Last year when we were discussing the environmental insurance, comments were made that AIG, which was the largest insurer at the time, was no longer in the market, and there was concerns about whether or not one would be able to obtain insurance for the rail trail. The good news is the market is still very vibrant. We were able to get 4 quotes. The proposals came in between $21,000 and $39,000, again indicating to me, and I'm not an expert in this area, that the risk is somewhat low and the insurers are comfortable because they know what the contaminants are in these types of projects, and so they are willing to insure it. What isn't available anymore is the subsidy. There used to be a subsidy that was available for approximately half of the premium cost. That subsidy is no longer available. And in our discussions with friends of the Dover Greenway, they are fully aware that the subsidy is not available, and they will make sure that funds are available to procure the full 5-year insurance policy. I'm not really going to go into detail about the policies. I think we did a lot of that in our last meeting. But instead, I'm going to turn to the due diligence and funding, which is on the next slide, and almost what are our next steps. So I wanted to reiterate that the town will not execute a lease until we have completed our due diligence. And this evening, and our negotiations with the lease, and the conversations that we have had with consultants are all part of our due diligence. But even after town meeting, if the town were to say, go ahead and execute the lease, everybody needs to understand that at that point, there is still due diligence that needs to happen. You know, we are trying to get a license agreement with the MBTA that would allow us to do title searches, which are important, to ensure that there are no abandonment issues that we're going to face. So there's a lot of due diligence that is happening right now and still needs to happen after town meeting. You know, we also, a very important aspect of this whole arrangement is the town made clear to us at town meeting that they did not want to spend town funds to build a rail trail. And so it is important for us as a town to have an agreement with Friends of the Dover Greenway so that we all understand what has to happen, how much it's going to cost, so that we have assurances as a town that pledges that have been made are going to be fulfilled prior to us executing the lease. One of the issues that have come up, and it did come up at the selectmen's meeting in February, well, what is a yes vote? Is this binding? What does it mean? And I believe the town moderator stood up and said, well, town meeting is only authorizing the Board of Selectmen to sign the lease. They are not obligated to sign the lease. I want to make sure that what we all understand about authorization and then ultimate execution is town meeting gives the Board of Selectmen that authorization, because in our executive power, it is unrealistic for us to bring to town meeting a fully negotiated lease for any lease that we bring to town meeting. And so the town, when they provide us with authorization, is telling the Board of Selectmen, go ahead, use your best efforts to negotiate a lease that will be best for the town, and then you have the authorization to execute that lease. One of the commitments that we've made to the town here is that so long as the ultimate lease that we are able to negotiate with the MBTA is not substantively different from the one that we've brought to town meeting, we will be comfortable to execute that lease in the event there were a yes vote. And we have asked council to make that determination as to whether or not substantive changes have been made to the final lease that we may or may not execute. The other issue that came up at the last meeting was, the other thing I thought I would go for, I got ahead of myself here. One of the things that I thought I would get, that I would also think about, well, what does it mean if we vote no? You know, what does it mean to the town if the town says we don't want the Board of Selectmen to negotiate the lease? So we don't have the exclusive right. We aren't the only party that can negotiate a lease with the MBTA. There has been a precedent that's been set where the MBTA has entered into a lease with other third parties. So that option potentially is available to third parties to negotiate directly with the MBTA. If that were to happen, you know, we as a town or the Board of Selectmen, we lose some control over the process. However, you know, any potential lessee would need to ensure that they are abiding by the all the regulations that we have in town, so zoning regulations, conservation regulations, safety issues. But as far as coming to town meeting to get approval, that would not be needed. So, you know, we should all be cognizant of that. I think I missed another point that I wanted to make here, and that was about the non-binding vote that's coming up. And I got ahead of myself. And, you know, we did teach, it was the other slide. You can't trust me when I do these things.
Yes.
So I need to do it myself. So, you know, as far as the non-binding vote goes, we did have a conversation with council after our meeting on February to ask about what are the obligations of the Board of Selectmen in connection with that non-binding vote. What does that vote mean? What is there something that the selectmen have to do if town meeting were to vote yes, go ahead and negotiate the vote, and then this non-binding vote came in and said no? And as far as that is non-binding, and it's a data point for us. The selectmen do not have to act on the outcome of that vote. And I know I had said that we would discuss that with council and bring back the answer to all of you. We'll take questions later. So at that point, see, you're almost ahead of the game. So, you know, this wraps up the formal part of our presentation. I would like to ask everyone to please be respectful of all points of view that we're going to hear. Also, I'm going to ask that you don't repeat questions or comments. I am going to be strict this evening. We do want to hear everybody's point of view, but we'd only like to hear it once. So thank you all, and with that, I will take your comment, so questions. You have to come up to the mic, identify yourself.
Tara Nolan, Cranberry Lane. Just a clarifying question. Did you say both a yes? I understand the authorization's non-binding, you don't have to execute. Did you also say a no vote was also non-binding, so the town could vote no and you could still choose to execute the lease?
Said that, it was an error on my part.
I may have said it.
I got excited.
All right.
But, you know, the point we were trying to make was that the non-binding vote or a ballot question, the Board of Selectmen do not have to act on that. It's not an action item. Any other questions?
Dale Freed, 3 Forest Street. The insurance policy, just a question, the $21,000 to $39,000, that was for a five-year span, is that correct? And then presumably you would keep going at that rate kind of indefinitely, or was that just for the construction phase? I didn't quite catch that.
Okay, so the statute allows you to buy a five-year policy, and that provides the defense against the need to indemnify it.
Okay.
So the idea is it covers the construction phase of the trail when you're most likely to encounter contaminants and need something in place for that. Okay. One could stop at that point when the 5 years is up and never renew the policy, or you could get quotes to see what kind of coverage is available, see whether it's cheaper, because now it's in place and that risk is behind you, and evaluate whether or not it makes sense to buy another policy. But the one that ties into the statute is one prepaid five-year policy.
And those policies are online, and there's a summary of that. We've tried to put all the current data on the front page of the website, and there are links to all of that. So I do encourage everybody to go onto the website and look at it in more detail. And if you have questions, you can email us directly, and we will answer those for you.
Janet Greenwood on Hawthorne Lane. I'd like to clarification. If the rail trail is voted down, and you talked about another organization being able to lease that land, what about Eversource, which has leased railroad beds, paths, and has paved some of them? Would they be permitted to do that without any town approval?
Yes, MBTA reserves the right, with or without the lease, to have other third parties that they can have leases or licenses, easements or whatever, down their corridor for anything from a gas pipeline to something else, okay? So that is just a reality that exists in dealing with the MBTA.
Is it true also that Eversource can, is it true that Eversource can go ahead and lease for, say, high tension lines, even if we have a rail trail, correct?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Those
you have to identify.
How do you spell that?
Want me to repeat it?
Yes.
No. The lease includes the entire length of the railway, right? From shore to shore, so to speak.
So if you remember.
Why has that been done when the article only includes Springdale to Hunt Drive? Is that correct?
So the leased premises, can you put the picture back up?
Did I read it correctly?
Yes, but let me explain it to everyone else who might not have read it yet, so hang on a sec. I'm just getting the picture back up on the screen here.
You messed with Mr. Clark this evening.
You can just leave that one up all the way through, probably. It's a good point of reference. Okay, so the corridor goes all the way from the top right to the bottom left, down to town line. The leased premises, that is covered by the lease in the first instance, only goes from Hunt to Denham. That stretch that was approved the last time around at town meeting. I went and I negotiated the option for the town, if it wanted to in the future, to add to the leased premises the section at the bottom from Hunt to the town line, and the second section toward the top from Dedham to Senator Street. However, nothing on the far side of Center to the Charles River or the Charles River Bridge is even covered by the option, okay? So the leased premises is just the strip that is to Hunt to Dedham. The other two are completely at the town's option should the town decide to exercise that in the future. The idea was, if you're going to do this exercise, do it once, get it right, have an option that you can exercise, but you're not obligated to include it under your leased premises.
I got another question. The selectmen say they will sign the lease. Does that include all three selectmen, and are they mandated to sign it if it passes?
Can I jump in for a second? So, as I understand it, this is a public educational forum. There is no deliberation by the board tonight, so they cannot sit here and discuss that question among themselves. I think the idea is that it's informational, that Robin's conveying what she understands is the situation, but the selectmen literally cannot deliberate that here tonight. They can do that at a board of selectmen meeting posted for the purpose, but they shouldn't do that tonight.
I know. What if? What if one of the board of selectmen or two of them choose not to sign? They're free to do that, I believe.
May I respond? Okay. The way it works.
Can you answer
is,
that yes or no?
No, I can't answer that yes or no.
You're a lawyer. You know this. You're a lawyer too.
So, town meeting is the legislature, and they authorize the signing of the lease.
Right.
They cannot mandate that the selectmen sign the lease. That's if right. The selectmen, as the chief executive officers,
so
of
if the selectmen
decide not to, despite town meeting authorization, the selectmen don't have to sign it. But I would expect between now and town meeting, the selectmen will deliberate that issue at an open meeting and give a clear signal where they stand. Once they have the MBTA's response to the draft lease, which is our ask, but not yet a commitment from the MBTA.
Well, God forbid that the Board of Selectmen changes, and you might have somebody that would refuse to sign, or two people that would refuse to sign. Everything is possible.
I think you've made your point.
You understand me?
I certainly do.
Thank you.
Are there any more questions?
Freed, 34th Street. Are there any legal agreements between the town of Dover and any organizations that could be impacted with the proposed rail trail that you know of?
Not that I'm aware of.
I'm glad you asked. Added the last words, not that I know of. But I certainly don't know all the agreements.
Right.
It's a very good question.
It's a very good question. So it's our homework for this evening.
Ted Sullivan, 198 Center Street. I know we've been talking about from Hunt Drive to Springdale, but I was reading the Medfield feasibility study, and it says one of the great potentials of a trail running from Medfield Needham Junction is the possibility of getting commuter traffic off the road and on the bike path. And it goes on to say that basically their intent is to connect from Medfield to Needham Junction train station. What is the long-term plan for this rail trail, please? Thank you.
As far as the lease goes, that's a repeat of what I said about the slide that's up here. The town is not leasing the section from center to the bridge under this lease as drafted either in the first instance or as an option. The only thing the town would be leasing, if authorized, in the first instance is the leased premises as labeled on this slide. The other two are options for the future if the town determines to exercise one or both of those options.
So I actually also saw that in the Medfield report. And, you know, what we're talking about this evening and what the town of Dover requested for the Board of Selectmen to do at the town meeting was just the lease premises or the portion of the rail trail that we have shown over here.
What's so interesting about this, it talks about the trail being open.
Do you want to try lift that? I feel so bad.
That's okay.
Everybody keeps...
But it talks about they don't want commuters to have to use the trail or be on the street after dark, so the trail would be open after dark. And I think we should really flush this out before the lease is signed if our sister city to the south of us, their plan is to connect through Dover, and what hours will the trail be operating? I think we should address this before this is signed. Thank you.
There won't be any lighting on the trail, so it would be treacherous at night.
Okay, I'm just referring to what they wrote here.
No,
so.
Thank you.
Hi, Mary Crane. Number one, how did we get to that one option?
What do you mean by the one option?
As opposed to the other two.
So the lease premises were...
Who decided that, though?
I think it was the town at town meeting.
Were the other options ever brought up?
Well, the option to lease the entire parcel was, well, first... was brought up and mm-hmm. is part of the feasibility study. Mm-hmm. And then in an attempt to negotiate a lease or a portion of a lease that may have been acceptable to more people in the town, there was a lot of resistance to that part of Center Street and option A and B, you know, the two option portions. So I think at the time, it felt as though there was more support to just lease the section that we're presenting.
Because the Bay State Trail, they also say it's going to go from Needham to Medfield. I mean, they've published that. That's the entire thing.
Right, and what, you know, and I understand the disconnect, and there is the potential for the trail to connect. What the town of Dover is asking the town to approve is our section to be leased.
And then if
somebody else could sign a lease or enter into a lease with the MBTA for those two sections.
Like another group?
Yep.
Could take it from Dover Center to Needham?
They could potentially.
Okay. And then the second thing was, early on in this process, somebody was speaking and they talked about all the contamination on the railroad bed, and that they said that you couldn't, if the rail trail were built, you couldn't just hop on the rail trail from wherever you were. You were only allowed to get on at the start or the finish because of all the contamination that's already in all those soils. So you couldn't just run up the railroad bed and hop on, you know, from your house or wherever you were meeting your friends. So you're not taking away the whole berm to get rid of it, just going to build something on the top of it.
Contain the contamination.
But the sides wouldn't be contained.
But the contamination's there today.
Well, I realize that, but you're not inviting people to hop up there.
Well, you know, there's going to be access points.
There'll be other access points besides Hunt Drive and Dover Center?
Those will be the two access points.
Okay. Thanks, Travis.
This might be more for town. I don't know if you're town. The council, who's at the table. Oh, Tara Nolan, Cranberry Lane. If there was concern about connecting to Needham, would the town be in a better position to lease the whole thing and then just choose not to develop it so they would control it rather than leaving it open for some other person
to lease?
So that's a really good question. And, you know, once you lease the rail bed, you really need to remove the railroad ties. Is that correct, Council?
Yes, generally speaking, when you sign the lease, you're signing on to improving the trail in accordance with the lease. So it would need further work on a lease to accomplish what you're trying to do, which is lock up the whole thing, develop part of the thing. So we thought the better way to do that was with the lease premises and the option to lease. It's going to be a recorded notice of that in the registry, and anyone who's trying to lease it is going to essentially have to deal with our option.
Good evening. Andres Rabella, Haven Terrace. Just a quick follow-up on the option comments, Mr. Anderson. Once the lease is negotiated and those options are negotiated into the lease, what will it require for the town to actually trigger those options?
That's a good question. That depends on the motion that's approved, if it is approved at town meeting. If the motion authorizes the board essentially to sign the lease, the exercise of that option, I'd have to check with other people at my firm, but my reaction here is would rest with the Board of Selectmen. If town meeting wants to retain control of that, it would authorize the board to lease the leased premises, and if in the future the town is going to exercise the option, come back to town meeting to get a further vote of the town to do so.
So it would require an additional vote, or could the town trigger one of those options without additional vote or town meetings?
It depends on how you structure the motion for town meeting this spring. You either give all of the authority to the selectmen, sign the lease, and retain the right to exercise the option in the future, or sign the lease for the leased premises, come back to us in the future if you want to exercise the option.
I just thank you for that. I just have a quick follow, a different question, my original question. In regards to the liability protections that you covered earlier, I'm curious as to whether any of those are dependent on the railroad company declaring formal abandonment of the corridor. In other words, does the Rail to Trails Conservancy, you know, only protect you if there's actual abandonment filed in a formal legal way, or are those protections available without formal abandonment? And if I could add a follow-up to that, is there any contingencies being built into the funding related to potential challenges to the title associated with that corridor? Thank you.
Okay. So the MOU is being drafted. It's in my court. It's in process, but it's not fully drafted. But certainly one of the intentions is to flesh out what the potential costs are and think through, make sure there's enough contingency available to address those kind of issues. The title search, as I mentioned, is the cost of that is being solicited as we speak. Abandonment research has begun. We are trying to nail down these issues. We're trying to do it sort of in steps, because nothing is authorized by town meeting yet. You don't want to go too far too fast and have town say no. On the other hand, you want to get as much information as you can that would be useful to the town, and we're trying to balance that set of ideas as we go forward. As far as the abandonment goes, no, you don't have to abandon the railroad right-of-way in order to avail yourself of the defenses, because the defenses are there for using it as a rail trail or being a tenant under a lease for a particular purpose. Okay? So the word abandon is used in the statute in certain places, but I don't think it is in the formal legal sense that you're talking about, where it's there's a notice of the railroad company abandoning its right in an easement, and then there's a procedure that's set up whether or not that happens. I don't think it's that. I think what it means is something that used to be a railroad and is now a rail trail, there is defense available in the statute as long as you do the list of criteria that are set out there.
Pope Hoffman, 12 Rocky Brook Road. I've got two questions. One has to do with the potential ballot. We know it's not a ballot yet for the town election because there have been sign-up sheets going around. Assuming that, I think it's a selectman determine whether that goes to a ballot question or not?
No. As long as the correct number of votes
okay.
are obtained, it will be a ballot question. I'm not stating anything out of turn.
And what would that ballot question actually be? In favor of a railroad trail or not?
That's the question.
So if, but that's still not a binding question,
Correct.
It's not, it's a non-binding.
I understand that the authorization for the lease is non-binding, so that's also non-binding question. So then what happens if the majority say they want a rail trail, but it's not binding? You can say no. Right? That's question one.
The best thing for you to do, whether you're in favor or opposed to the rail trail, is go to town meeting and vote on the authorization
right.
of the lease, either thumbs up or thumbs down.
Okay. That's still a little confusing to me, but because it's non-binding.
So let me try, okay?
Okay.
Because it is confusing. So at town meeting, the warrant article authorizes the selectmen to enter into a vote
right.
or not. So a yes vote would authorize the Board of Selectmen to move forward with
the negotiation.
Right.
right.
And just like any lease that we get authorization at town meeting for, the selectmen have to continue the negotiations and
right.
ensure that the intent of the lease was the same intent that was represented at town meeting. And that being the case, you know, usually the selectmen execute the lease.
Right. No, I understand
so,
that
right,
part.
The warrant, the ballot question, is just that. It's a non-binding ballot question. It's informational in a sense. So it will give the town a data point as to whether or not the citizens of Dover would like this rail trail. So that's what it is. It's a data point.
And then who determines if the lease is negotiated successfully in Dover's interest? Who actually determines if the rail trail is built or not?
Well, that's a loaded question because, you know, the selectmen have the authorization
right.
to sign the lease.
Right.
However, we have represented that unless we have all the money in the bank, we're not going to execute the lease.
Right.
So, in a sense, it's the Board of Selectmen and the Friends of the Dover Greenway because they need to raise all the money
right.
because the town made it clear, I think we all heard that,
yeah.
that the town did not want to spend town funds to build the rail.
And the
so is it as clear as mud now? Or you?
The cost of it is... $941,000 up
no,
to,
that's more than that.
According to the study, up to $1.3
right.
million. Dollars.
Right.
And from my understanding, the Friends have to raise all that money and assure you that they've got that money. What happens if they...
It has to be in the bank.
Oh, okay. I didn't know. It's got to be in the bank. Okay.
Right. And not only that, we also... And that's why this MOU with the Friends is so important because it's going to spell out the terms of the town's deal with the Friends of the Dover Greenway.
Okay.
And, you know, one of the things we also have talked to them about is ensuring that there's a perpetual fund in place for continued maintenance of the rail bed. We have to make sure there's insurance in there. We have to make sure there's a contingency fund. We all know how construction projects go. So there's a lot still to work out.
Oh, I understand. Is there going to be any time limit as to the Friends obtaining the money and having that money in the bank, or has that not been thought of yet?
So the idea is that funding would be coming in increments that match up to what is being done. So the first step is the due diligence, and there would be a license with the MBTA, which is sort of one step the side of a lease, a license to go in that property and do the design, identify the wetlands, flag them, do what you need to understand the nature of the construction project. Let's say that costs X to do the due diligence for that work. X needs to be in the bank in order for the town to go forward with the license and the due diligence. Then you get the plans, the specs, and so on. In order to put the specs out to bid to get a firm price to construct the trail, you need to have the money in the bank that meets the engineer's estimate of what it's going to cost to construct. Okay? Let's pretend that's $1 million. Okay? Friends need to donate $1 million before the town can go out to bid. Now let's pretend the bids come back at $1.3 million rather than $1 million, which was the engineer's estimate. Another $300 needs to go into the bank before the lease can be signed. And obviously I'm using round numbers. Right. It has to incorporate everything that the MOU is going to address in terms of the contingencies, et cetera, of what needs to go into making this project a reality. But the idea is, don't make people raise money for, you know, $1.5 million when due diligence might show that there's some kind of a showstopper out there, okay, an endangered species or something that is in way of constructing this thing.
Good answers. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Sorry, just to clarify, so you wouldn't sign the lease until all that money was actually in the bank? And then tell me about, I had never heard about the perpetual fund. So what's the number on that for the next 25 years?
Well, we're going to work with a consultant and Friends of the Dover Greenway so that we can put together sufficient funds.
So that's not established yet by the time you sign, or would it be?
Everything will be established. There will be an agreement that we enter into with funding requirements. And, you know, from what I know right now, today, which may not be everything, the ongoing maintenance isn't tremendously expensive because you're putting stone dust down and you have to, in increments, replace it. But again, I'm not the expert. I'm not saying this is all we need to do. You know, we're going to work with the consultants to figure out, you know, what we can expect the cost to be on a 90, you know, for the term of the lease.
So the whole trail is stone dust, and it's hard enough that the kids ride their bikes and...
Did you read this?
Yes, I did, but
and
I'm just...
They even have pictures. And I, you know, I'm sure you go to Needham every once in a while, but the Needham rail trail is stone dust, and as are some of the trails in Wellesley. Like if you go, I'm not sure the names of the trails, but like if you go down, I think it's Washington Street in Wellesley, you can see, and those are all stone dust. It's really good on the knees.
Okay, I'd never heard about the perpetual fund. I didn't know how it was being funded. Thanks so much.
We're trying to think of everything.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Karen O'Sullivan, 103 Center Street. And one thing I wanted to draw attention to is that we need to remember that the proposed rail trail goes right through our conservation lands. It cuts right through our wetlands. And I didn't see anything in the feasibility study about a biodiversity study, a habitat study, an updated look at the biomap. And also something else that I found out last year was that there is a very strong body of evidence saying that the safest thing to do with the rail trail is to leave it as it is. It has been rewilded in many sections, and if you go out into the conservation land and you look at the ties, they've practically disappeared. Most of them are no longer there. Not most. Some of them are no longer there. And in the 46 Springdale study, the wildlife corridor was referenced, and that is the greenway, that the traditional greenway that runs right parallel to Centre Street. And one other thing that we need to remember is that it goes right through our water resource area, maybe not deep enough for the wells, but definitely for surface water. And one tree purifies 26 pounds of carbon dioxide every year. So that's something that we need to remember as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Ted Gramer, 31 Centre Street. I guess my request for all of you is, you know, having been in Dover 17 years, the governance has been really excellent, and we've done a really good job of planning long-term, whether it's the Carroll School or parks, and we understand the phases. I think this is a really challenging topic for a lot of people because it's not clear what we're really building here, and I think in other examples we did the phases, and I think it would be really helpful if all of you as a board could really take that leadership role of helping the town understand what we're committing to here. And if there are multiple phases and this is going to be an end trail, let's bring that to the people. If we want it to be a shorter trail, let's bring that. But I think this is really hard. We don't take on many projects in Dover here where we build a little stub and we vote on that. And I think the work on the legal is great, but the big questions you've heard here tonight are just, what is this really going to be? And I feel like that hasn't been part of the discussion here. And it would be great if you guys, as the leadership team, really help the town understand what are we voting on? Because I don't think it's as simple as, do you want a rail trail or not? There's a lot of options you've gone through today, and I think it's complex for most people in town to understand.
Right, and I appreciate your comments, but you know what we're also trying to convey to the town is we, as a governing body, don't have all the authorization. You know, other bodies could come in and negotiate to put a rail trail in our town. Yep. And we just want to make sure that everybody is cognizant of that as well. And you know, we are trying, and in an attempt to be transparent, to get all the information out, and maybe we can think about delivering it in a different format. Maybe it has been somewhat confusing. So I do appreciate your comments, and we will, you know, we're having these forums in an attempt to make sure that we're correctly conveying information and to get comments from citizens so we understand what we may not be addressing. So it is very important to all of us on this board to ensure that we are addressing all of the issues, and you know, we certainly know we can't think all of them up ourselves, so thank you.
No, thank you, and I think the piece that's challenging is just the information that comes out and the vote is about this, and then everyone sees this.
Okay, so you know, that's an excellent point. We will attempt to clarify that language, so I do appreciate you bringing that down.
Thank you.
I think I'd like to try to clarify this.
You need to identify yourself.
Right. Kevin Band, 7 Pleasant Street. When we started the Friends of the Dover Greenway, really the vision was to do the whole expanse. And after talking to people like you, Ted, and others, we decided that wasn't the right vision. And we, you know, we talked about that together. So much so that at the time we were aligned with PCRTA, whose vision was to do the whole expanse. And so what we did at that point was we didn't share that vision, and so we went about the business of starting a not-for-profit, Friends of the Dover Greenway, so that it could be specifically a Dover event. I mean, that was really the vision, because we were trying to build community and not try to destroy it. And so it was because of your feedback that we've ended up with really what's Dedham to Hunt, right?
A segment.
The segment, okay. Because we listened to the town and we clearly heard that people were uncomfortable with the concept of connecting the entire expanse. And not only, I'll mention parenthetically, that the bridge itself would cost somewhere around $1 million, if not more. So what we did was we went through all of that effort to listen. We went through the effort of starting a not-for-profit so that we wouldn't take money through BCRTA, and so that we could represent this town and what we understood it to really want. So to hear you now say you're confused by this confuses me, since we've met so many times to discuss it. But it is true to say that BCRTA has a vision that would include connecting Needham and Dover all the way through Medfield. And Medfield has that vision as well, apparently. Although our selectmen aren't bound in any way by what they write.
And it's just, you know, their feasibility study is available on their town website, if anybody...
Yeah, I mean, they can say what they'd like, but that doesn't bind our selectmen. What I will tell you is that, and I've said this before, and I want to say it again on public record, the Friends of the Dover Greenway could, if the town were to pass on this, enter into a lease with the MBTA. We could do it ourselves. And we could do anything we want at that point. We could connect, if we could somehow raise that much money, the bridge in Needham all the way through to Medfield. But we will not do that. I say this in a public forum. I assume we're being taped, because we're trying to build community, we're not trying to rip it apart. Having said that, could BCRTA come in and then pave, not stone dust, pave? Yes, they could. Could DCR do that? Yes, they could. Could Eversource do that? Yes, they could. So again, I just want to make sure that we have some institutional memory about the Friends of the Dover Greenway and the way in which we have approached this, which we believe and continue to believe is very friendly towards the citizens of this town. So I hope that brings some clarity. I think the ballot vote will create some confusion. We're trying to keep it simple and to keep our intentions clear. So I hope that helps.
Thank you.
Martha Boland, Partridge Hill Road, Donnelly Estates. I'd like to talk about the issue of parking. As it is now, the parking lots that we have for the various trail systems, Nuwanit, Powisset, are still overcrowded. We put in a new parking lot on Powisset Street. In the fall and the spring, throughout the summer, cars are still parked along Powisset Street on both sides sometimes. So parking has become a real issue. So in regards to the access points at Hunt Drive and also at the center of town, what are your thoughts for parking? Are we going to see a parking lot on Hunt Drive? Those are major concerns. I live in the neighborhood. We deal with the traffic coming through all the time. And at this point, I think adding a parking lot to Hunt Drive would certainly devalue the neighborhood and the properties there.
So the feasibility study outlines the parking, and it assumes that the municipal parking lots in the town of Dover will be utilized to access the trail.
The center of Dover, but what about where you had said that people can't, as Mary had said, access the trail from their backyards?
I would have to go back and reread the document. I don't recall, but you know, it's a 1.5 mile trail. I really can't imagine a lot of people driving to it. But perhaps I'm wrong. You know, I will go back and read the document and get an answer to you.
Okay.
But that is, I want you to know that that's
I completely understand.
A real concern of my neighborhood.
This evening, we're taking notes for questions that potentially weren't answered. So we will make sure that at the next public forum, we do have an answer to that question.
Okay.
All right? Thank you. Mr. Crowley, is there somebody else who would like to speak? Because you have been up here twice. Okay. With two questions. I'm keeping tabs.
Would the Greenway have the ability to convey the lease to somebody else? And would the town have the ability to convey the lease to somebody else?
I leave that to council to answer.
Let me look at the lease and I'll get back to you on this.
That's a question we need to get back. Are you pleased now? You asked a question we can't answer. That's not a nice thing to say.
Valerie Lynn, 14 Haven Terrace. One of the things that I think is so beneficial of this trail is getting people off of our streets and onto a safe right-of-way. And it just kind of was reinforced with me this morning when I was trying to take my kids to school and there was yet another accident at the intersection of Haven and Center Streets. And Center Street is one of the very few streets in our community that has a sidewalk. Yet, I did a little bit of research and in 2015 there were 40 accidents on Center Street. In 2014, 26 accidents. I wasn't able to get the data for last year, but I think it's concerning that one of the few streets in our community that has a sidewalk and where the youngest in our community are walking, mothers with strollers and young children, happens to be one of the streets that probably has about the highest accident rate in our community as well. So I hope that we all take into consideration that one of the wonderful things about this trail, one of the great opportunities here is to get people off of our streets, many like Claybrook and others that are very windy, where people are trying to walk and jog and getting run off into the ditch as cars are coming around the corners. This would be a huge benefit for many of us in the community who are active outside.
Thank you.
Okay.
Do you have an answer already?
Of course. This is the assignment question, section 21 of the draft lease. The town shall not, without the prior written consent of the MBTA, transfer or assign the lease or any part hereof. Such consent may be withheld in the sole discretion of the MBTA. So that's what it says.
Hi, George Cimento, 42 Powysit Street, and I'm here today to just officially put on record the position of the Norfolk Hunt Club. I've spoken with some of the boards already. We cannot support a rail trail. Essentially, the club's been here since 1901. The property, which is on Center Street, is roughly 50-some-odd acres in trust for us, some of it actually bought by Hunt Club members, and virtually all of this land that the rails cross was donated by horse families. We've got, Mr. Edmund Rice, the Rice property. He was a former president of the Norfolk Hunt. We've got Wild property, not fully donated, but bought at a pretty good price from a horse family. The land from the Russells, who delighted in seeing the hunt come into their backyard. And then our most famous member, Amelia Peabody, whose generosity to this town, you just can't put a price on it. She was the big contributor to purchase much of the Donnelly property that now is owned by the Land Conservation Trust. Now, this is not about, oh gee, we bought it, it's ours. The reality is that as Dover is becoming less and less a rural town and more a suburb, unfortunately, like a lot of other suburbs, we're finding that the Hunt Club is being crowded out. I don't even think we would have this discussion if it was 25 years ago. In the last 25 years, we've got a new type of machine. It's a nice, clean machine, but it's still a machine, the trail bike. Essentially, the way we see this happening, if Medfield puts in its trail, it's going to come to the border. Now, whether we go to Hunt Drive or to the border is almost immaterial. We think what will happen, based on our experience with Nohanet Woodlands, is that this attraction of a trail is going to attract not just cyclists from Medfield or Dover. It's going to become a regional attraction. And, you know, that's exactly understandable. This is beautiful land. If you ride your bike to it, you then don't necessarily stay on the rail trail. There are going to be places, in fact, certainly we're going to need places with horses to get across it. Those places, and maybe just illegal decisions to go down the bank, are going to basically fill these woods with trail bikes. There will also be with the trail bikers, if Nohanet's any experience, a whole bunch of unleashed dogs keeping their masters and mistresses company. Now, this is not a great big wide path that the hunt uses. This is fairly narrow. It's hemmed in on one side by wetlands, the other side by the rails. Why do we need it? It's not just so that people can be on horses. The whole thing that makes us a hunt club is that we breed hounds. Right now, we've got 21 couples in the kennels. The pups come out every year. That's 42 hounds. Now, if you don't have hounds, you're not a hunt club. You're a riding club. And this is very important. I'll tell you why in a minute. But for those hounds, they need to be taught.
Mr. Chimental, this is really interesting, but.
Well, I'm okay. I will. Well, let me keep it very short. What we are concerned about is what we think will be a proliferation of trail bikes and unleashed dogs. We will not be able to safely use this property with hounds. The land that is in trust for us could be in jeopardy, and it is an enormous decision. Now, next, I do want to switch over to something that's not Hunt Club. It's your comment about the non-binding proposal. Essentially, as I understand it from Jim Rapetti's explanation, town meeting vote is advisory to the selectmen. It's not binding.
I never said it was binding.
Okay, may I finish, please?
Vote authorizes
it does, but it's essentially advisory, is it not?
I beg your
pardon. It's advisory in nature.
It's authorization.
It's advisory.
The only reason it's authorization is because the Board of Selectmen need the ability and the flexibility to be able to negotiate final terms of any agreement. That's why the language is as such.
But do you not have the discretion, notwithstanding town meeting vote, to say, hey, we won't do it? You do, legally.
And
that is exactly what Jim said. So I'm trying to understand.
I think we have made a very good, given a very good explanation to this point.
So you have not.
Is there,
may I please ask my question? I thought I had a chance to talk here.
You certainly do.
Thank you. Now, what is of concern? The town meeting vote itself is advisory in nature. You don't need to follow it, according to the town moderator. It's advisory. I'm trying to understand why the advisory vote that is been approved by an overwhelming number of people, why that will be disregarded, which seems to be what you say, a data point. And it sounds as if there has already been a determination by some of you, if not all of you, that you're going to disregard the advisory vote and follow strictly the town meeting vote. Is that correct?
No.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. I think that advisory vote has exactly the same standing as town meeting vote.
And
you should look to see how do people vote.
You asked me to get an explanation from town council, and that is the explanation I got. Whether whether we're going to disagree on what authorization means or not, you know, that may be the case. But that's what town council.
Robin, you know I like you. I hate to seem adversarial, but you've got my point on that. And again, I did want to be on record for the club. and thank you very much for this forum.
Mr. Anderson.
Yes.
Let me see if I can flip this around.
Sure.
To what I'm intuiting is your viewpoint, okay? If an overwhelming majority of the town vote on this referendum question, yes.
Yes.
In a much smaller group of the town at town meeting votes no, the answer is no. That is why you need to come to town meeting and vote whether you want to authorize or not authorize the lease.
Essentially, then the town meeting vote, Mr. Anderson, is, you believe, binding, whereas the advisory vote is not binding.
May I?
This is important because, you know, we've gotten a lot of signatures.
In order to authorize the lease, there must be an affirmative vote of town meeting. If there's not an affirmative vote of town meeting, there is no authorization to sign the lease. So, step one, town meeting votes. If it says no, end of discussion.
Agreed.
If it says yes, it is an authorization, but not a requirement that the Board of Selectmen sign the lease. Let's say, at the last minute, the MBTA said, well, you know, we thought we were going to do this, but it ain't over till it's over. Actually, the only lease we're going to sign is the one that's posted on our website as the unedited version of the RailTrail lease. I would then go to the Board of Selectmen and say, in my view, I think there are substantive changes to the document that was before town meeting. And if your authorization is to sign it substantially in the form that was voted on, I would advise you not to sign it because it is way different than town meeting thought they were voting on. Mm-hmm. So then it would have to either die or come back to town meeting on that form of lease. I'm not expecting that the T would do that to us. They've been working with us in good faith. If they're going to say no, I would expect they're going to say no as soon as possible rather than after town meeting, but that's just a theoretical way this thing could change so that town meeting has said yes, but it's so different than you thought you were voting on that the board in good conscience may, after deliberation, what they're not doing tonight, say no, okay? It's a complicated situation with a legislative branch, which is town meeting,
yes,
and an executive branch, which is the Board of Selectmen.
But it is authorization, not a mandate.
Correct.
And if, in fact, there is an approval at town meeting, and I'm just trying to think if I were a selectman, if there is then an advisory vote with a larger turnout where there is not support for a rail trail, at that stage, I would think the selectmen, in deference to the wishes of the largest group having a vote, would then decide not to sign the lease. And that would be their legal right.
Can I just say that this should not be debated here tonight? Okay, this is a question that's legitimate, and you should think about it in an open meeting to deliberate it. But I think you're sort of cherry-picking the results you want. You're happy if town meeting votes no. You're unhappy if town meeting votes yes. Therefore, you want, what you say, a larger group of the town to vote no. But the governance of a New England town is town meeting. So that's the legislature that decides yes or no on the lease. That's where you need to make your case.
Thank you. I do regret your use of that word cherry picking, but otherwise, that's a fair opinion. Thank you.
George, can I ask you a question?
Certainly.
I want to see if I just have this right. You said to us that your fear is not for the horses, it's for the hounds.
The liability associated with training the hounds, that's okay. Correct.
So you've also said that the hounds have been here for, you said to me 100 and...
Really, the kennels were built in 1903.
The club has been hunting since before that, apparently. 80 years prior to that?
Yes, that's right.
Okay, almost 180 years.
No, a little over 100 years.
A little over 100 years.
Yes.
Do you know when the railroad was built?
Yeah, well, it predates the club. Yeah.
No.
Doesn't it?
I don't know. What did the hounds do when the rail trail was a railroad?
You know, I think they, not having been there then, I think they probably knew what the schedules were and planned around it.
It ran in the morning. The train ran in the morning. Right.
Yeah. Okay. Well, listen, thank you. I appreciate this.
Thank you. Thanks, George. Yes, sir.
Rick Nagy, 25 Grand Hill Drive, also Donnelly Estates. Two questions.
Sure.
First question, with regard to the parking issue. I know you said you'd go back and research it a bit. Is, knowing Hunt Drive and how tight it is, and how it's private property on either side, if there is a need to expand parking or something like that, is there a possibility that the town would have to seize property by eminent domain or any other method in order to build some sort of parking facility there?
I do not believe so, but we can look into that.
Okay, I think that would be good to check into. I assume on the other side we wouldn't need to do that because of the town parking lot. Okay. Other question. We've talked how there will only be two entrances, one on Hunt and one on Springdale. But there's going to be a lot of private property along it that will abut it and would easily come up, you know, would be very easy to enter if you wanted to. What's the reasoning behind why people aren't going to be allowed to do that?
Contamination.
Trespassing on private property.
Sure, but if the people that are there legally that own the property or anything else were to go onto it, the reason that we don't want to allow that is for contamination, or?
That's what we were told at, a year ago, that mm-hmm. on the sides, accessing it from backyards and whatnot compromises the finished top. Mm-hmm. So from that standpoint.
Got it. And what would the risk be if there were that? If people did violate that and go ahead with that, what would the issue of the contamination be? Like, what would the risk to the environment be if that were to happen?
I think it would be more a concern for the user, okay. Shoes and things of that sort. I think some families have been concerned about young children and things of that sort.
Got it. Okay. Thanks.
Kate Pumont, T194 Center Street. I appreciate you looking into the insurance issues, and I know you gave the example of we'd get coverage, say a piece of equipment was working and maybe they had a spill or something, but would this insurance that we could purchase, would that cover us for things that might already be on that trail that we don't know? You know, I know it's undetermined exposure, but would we have insurance?
Answer that question.
And while he's trying to look up.
Go ahead.
Could you explain how, if they were to start taking the rail trail out, would they be taking the trucks from the rails? Would they be taking trucks only from the Hunt Drive and the Springdale points to haul the everything from the center?
So those are the fine details of the construction project, and you know, when and if we get to that point, we will definitely determine the logistics of how they will be removed and where trucks will go in. And, you know, and that would be, we would have to meet with the chief of police to ensure that we aren't impacting traffic in any way.
Yeah. So on the rail trail environmental insurance question,
yes.
We have a large graph that shows what's covered and not by the four different insurance companies that gave quotes. So I'm going to try to simplify it. There's a lot of fine print in the quotes and there would be in the policy. Think about on-site, meaning on the rail trail property, and off-site.
Okay.
Okay? Think about pre-existing conditions or a new release. All right? So that's the matrix.
Okay.
All right? So also there could be BI, bodily injury, and property damage. Okay?
Yes,
well, so now we've made it a little more complicated. But coverage could be subject to all the terms and conditions, blah, blah, blah. Yes, for BI, bodily injury, and property damage on-site or off-site, whether it's new or pre-existing. Okay? It's different with the pre-existing contamination on-site. Okay? On-site, it is no or very limited coverage under the policies. So you cannot clean up with the insurance money the pre-existing contamination on-site. Okay? Off-site, there is a lot of qualifications that are, there's some off-site coverage that for cleanup that you don't get with the on-site, okay? For a new release, whether it's on-site or off-site, yes, cleanup is coverage, okay? So there's a slide that's in the deck. The deck, I assume, is gonna be posted. I believe this is posted.
Yes,
I mean, there's a lot of information out there. I'm trying to summarize it, but the bottom line is, it's different whether it's on-site or off-site, new or pre-existing. And there's a lot of different caveats for each category.
I guess my concern is that I'm thinking about, we don't know, and that if there were over 2 miles of rail bed being hauled out, you know, there is potential for a truck to spill over and contaminate somebody's well. And I just don't, is that considered a pre-existing contaminant, or is that a new,
So, under the DEP's best management practices, ordinarily, you would not be hauling out truck after truck of contaminated soil. The whole idea is you leave what's there in place and contain it or cap it over with a rail trail construction. That's for typical pre-existing historical contamination in a railroad, like PAHs and arsenic and that sort of thing. There might be some other pre-existing condition. The report suggests there are not significant pre-existing conditions, but during design you might find something else out during due diligence or whatever. And if there is a significant pre-existing condition that requires some amount of removal off-site, what's in that truck is pre-existing contamination and is not covered by the cleanup. Right. However, if the truck tips over and releases it, the contractor should have an insurance policy that has sort of an all-risk kind of coverage, and depending on their policy, there could be insurance, not the rail trail insurance, but contractor insurance covering something that they cause during the course of their work.
Yeah,
yet another complication.
Right. So it's a pretty complex issue, but thank you.
Hi, Alan Moss, Haven Street. Can I just say, I've been coming to these meetings for a couple of years now, and the questions and comments tonight are excellent. We're finally nailing all the important things we need to answer and address and mitigate. I think if we can address all these, the hands included, We'll have the best rail trail in the state. Thank you.
I'm not going to take it personally. They said the questions are excellent, but how about the answers to it?
Hi, Kristen Brophy, 35 Center Street. First of all, thank you for all of your hard work and your due diligence. I have what I think are simple questions. My first one is, you spoke about the license agreement. Excuse me. If one is to enter into that license agreement, does that then require you to execute the lease? That's my first question. I have two more.
Should we do it one by one so I don't lose them?
Sure.
Yeah.
I don't know what our other questions are. They all pertain to the same thing. So variations on a theme.
So is it helpful to get each answered?
Sure. Yeah, go ahead.
No. The license allows you to do due diligence.
Okay.
Think of it, if you're buying a house and you get an inspector to go in and look at what you're doing and so on, and then you decide whether or not to sign on the dotted line. Okay, so this is on the rail trail. You're designing the trail, flagging the wetlands, looking at the conditions, etc., trying to figure out whether it's consistent with what you thought you were getting into with the feasibility study. But the license itself does not obligate you to sign the lease.
My second question is, when you're in that due diligence phase in the license agreement, are you required to move out of that to a next phase within a certain period of time? Like, meaning, can you only be in there for 18 months?
So the a standard license is posted on the MBTA's website,
mm-hmm.
and typically they go with a standard license. Ordinarily, it has a six-month term, but typically it goes up to 12 months. You know, that you either do it as 12 in the first place, or you go six, and then if you need more time, so on. So typically, we talked to Beals about this, and 12 months should be more than enough to do what he needs to do as far as designing it and flagging the wetlands, et cetera, to understand what is involved. The other footnote I should say is, town meeting approval is not required for a license, because it is not the lease, it's just the license. It's the access to get you onto the property to do the, The other thing, the license.
You know, some of the really important things are the title search.
Right, so you can do the title search. You don't need a license to do this title search, because that's in the Registry of Deeds,
mm-hmm.
but you do that in parallel as part of your due diligence. So you're getting answers to all the important questions as you go through. So by the end of this period, you've got sort of all the information that you're going to get in order to decide the question, should we execute this lease that we've been authorized to execute?
So there's not a strict requirement to move out of it, but typically it takes 6 to 12 months.
Yes.
And that's what the consultant was telling us. I mean, you could run into a hiccup, and maybe it takes you a little longer, and maybe it takes you less.
I'm a project manager, so
So you understand these things.
Yes. No, things go. And my third question is, if you sign a license agreement, are you then allowed to test the soil, or is that only when you execute the lease?
The latter. The license agreement does not typically allow you to test the soils.
Okay.
Now, I don't know whether we would get any headway in that, but I sincerely doubt it.
Okay. Thank you.
Karen O'Sullivan, 103 Center Street. I just wanted to say something on that point about licensing. When you spoke about it before, you mentioned that there would be scrubbing done at the side of the trail, and I would just like to make the point that before any scrubbing or removal of any material is done, or any disturbance of the soil or the habitats or the wildlife corridor, that we need to have an in-depth study done first. Thank you.
Stuart Swinney, 149 Dedham Street. Actually, my comment leads on from the last one. There's been a great deal of discussion about contaminants. I haven't seen in the report but I've read one or two things I didn't read. But when was the last time the rail bed was actually sprayed? It was mentioned of arsenic. I happen to know arsenic doesn't have a very long life. So that's not particularly bad. I didn't see any detailed study as to what, in fact, we can expect. And all right, the MBTA doesn't wish any studies to be done on that section that we're talking about tonight, but there must be empirical knowledge as what one could expect elsewhere in New England.
Right, well, there certainly is, because, you know, Needham just recently completed theirs, so that information is available to the public.
That would be useful if maybe it was part of your study so that we could see it in Dover, and to know when the bed was last used, which, what, about 20 years ago?
Right.
It is, in fact, part of the study. It's mentioned in the appendix.
I missed that then. Thank you.
And they also, you know, the study also goes into depth about the historical use of the rail bed. So it is actually quite informative.
All right. And finally, as a member of the Dover Historical Society, I'm acutely aware of the importance of the Norfolk Hunt to the history of this town. I mean, many changes took place at the turn of the last century because of its presence. So I think it's very important, the issues which were raised concerning the well-being of the hunt and their ability to use a certain property which could, I understand, be sold, broken up, if you no longer had access to it. So this is a detail of considerable importance, I feel.
Thank you. All right, well, there.
Andres Rapella, Haven Terrace. Just a quick follow-up question on Mr. Band's comments regarding the leasing of the corridor by third parties other than the town of Dover. Is there any particular liability protections that the town as a municipality has offered through the lease with the MBTA that a third party would not be granted on equal terms? In other words, is there an advantage to the town executing this lease versus the third party?
Just a question. When you're talking about the third party, do you mean like a utility company, third party, or a third party who's going to develop the rail trail?
I think Mr. Band mentioned a DCR or the Friends of the Greenway.
Okay.
A profit organization.
I said that the Friends of the Dover Greenway would not.
Right? Oh, I see.
I said, is that what that clear? Oh, yeah. All right, okay, I know the question. You're referring to BCRTA, or you're referring to Medfield, whatever they would establish.
Right, a non-municipality.
Just to be clear.
Right, so a non-municipality. Would they be afforded the equal protections from liabilities as the municipality itself, the town?
No, because there are some statutory protections that are built in for towns that are not built in for private parties.
Thank you.
Dale Freed, 34th Street. I'm still confused on the contamination thing. So the MBTA won't allow us under the license to go figure out what risk we're undertaking. They won't allow us to do soil samples, right? Did I hear that correctly?
I cannot speak for the MBTA, but I can speak from experience as to what might be going on here. If an owner owns a piece of property and has no reason to know that there is a reportable condition on the property, then the owner does not have to report it. You're never in the system.
Yeah.
Okay? If an owner allows someone else to come onto the property and test it, and it turns out there is a reportable condition, and the person who came on said, thanks for letting me on, see you later.
Right.
The owner now owns that problem.
Right.
So the owner would rather not know about the problem at all, i.e., rather not allow testing until the owner knows that somebody is serious about doing whatever it is they propose to do, i.e. sign a lease and build a rail trail, which covers over the contamination and deals with what's there, okay? So the idea, I think, of anyone in a position of an owner is don't take on a liability, right. i.e. allow the testing, unless you know that there's a solution to that, issue if the testing proves positive.
So if the MBTA were allowed you to test and you decided not to lease the land, then they would have to pay. Then they would have to pay for the rail trail, and it's not what they want to do.
Okay.
So in a sense, this is brilliant on the part of the MBTA.
Right. Absolutely.
They're getting, you know, towns are getting rail trails, but it's actually the cleanup method. So then
my question was, though, but the insurance policy that you talked about, if I understood right, in your matrix of pre-existing and not, and I forget what the matrix was, but the big gaping hole, in my opinion, was if you have a pre-existing contamination, it's not covered. Nobody covers that.
So Obamacare does not apply to the rail trail. There is no pre-existing coverage for on-site cleanup of contaminants that you are likely to find on a rail trail. Okay?
Because
it's
the mitigation.
Now, some of the policies, when you read the fine prints, and we'll get into the endorsements, et cetera, might say the excluded universe of contaminants is A through X. But if you have Y or Z, meaning stuff you don't know about, no reason to know about, not expected, et cetera, we will provide coverage for that.
Okay. All right. Okay.
It's very confusing.
Well, you cleared it up very well. Thank you. It was a good answer.
Thank you.
At last.
We got one good answer.
Yes.
The rest are just good questions.
Exactly.
All right. So I think on that note, we should end. It's a high.
Vardin Srinivasa, 5 Haven Terrace. I was sitting in the back. It was just kind of tough to read the map. Where's Haven Terrace on? Is that parcel B?
Up there.
Up in the top.
So it's parcel B?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So as far as...
The map is online. It's a much better version.
Yeah, this looks like it was 25 years old. So as far as like privacy and fences, does the town pay for any of that?
The town isn't paying for any of the rail trail.
So would like the private funds take care of that?
No.
No. I think it depends. If I recall, some of the friends do. I think you said you had done.
Yeah. So if the homeowner abuts this property. If a homeowner abuts the rail and wants some additional privacy, who pays for the fence and the additional shrubs?
So I believe that the Bailey Thomas report had a budget line item for screening.
For some screening.
So I think that there was vegetative screening, there was a budget for vegetative screening that was included in the feasibility study. So it's part of their preliminary estimate of the overall cost that we funded by the
All right, so there's some screening, but there's no fence, and we don't really control or approve the actual screening. So chances are it's probably not as good as what we would like to be.
Well, you're making assumptions. You don't know. I would really suggest that you go online and read.
To be serious here, I would probably spend $50,000 on landscaping. I highly doubt out of your $1 million, you're going to give me 50 grand. Is that fair to say? What are we doing here?
But I don't really think it is. Excuse me,
this evening, perhaps you could take this conversation offline.
Yeah, it could be a conversation for another time.
It sounds inflammatory to say that you're
going to So I'm there. This discussion can happen outside.
Does anyone else want to hear about this?
All right, so I think the town wants to hear about it.
But it's in the report, there is not a lot of information or money for screening, for personal screening of homes. There's the answer.
All right, so I'm...
Okay.
Someone abuts it, I have to drop 50 grand on landscaping.
But you're north of them anyway, so you wouldn't be affected by...
I thought you said Haven Terrace abuts.
This evening is not a conversation about how it's going to impact...
So that's why there's so much confusion here. I don't even know if my property abuts this. You're saying it is...
Well, I don't know where you live.
I think that's something that
I really don't understand how this is even...
Prior to coming to the meeting, that's probably something you should do on your own. Thank you for your question.
That's why I just came here.
Thank you for your question.
No one can even answer a question of my house.
It could be answered. I think what we're saying generally is that you haven't done the work for this meeting because all of this has been studied in great detail.
Excuse me?
It's a simple yes or no question.
Well, we don't know...
Excuse
me, sir? If you, there is a more detailed map in the Board of Selectmen's office. You can go in there and take a look at the map and see where your property lies. I can't answer the question.
I could answer the question.
Great, thank you.
Yeah. Haven Terrace would be Parcel B. It's not the original piece that we're talking about from Springdale South to Hunt Drive. Haven Terrace, abutting the rail trail, is the northern section up there.
Okay.
Hi there. Nicholas Serto, Morningside Drive. So my questions relate to traffic and safety. The first question that I have is, has the town done a study or, I guess, considered any influx of additional traffic coming in and out of Donnelly Estates to access the Hunt Drive access point?
I believe there were some items that were addressed in the feasibility or consideration made. I did not look in that in detail over the weekend.
Okay.
So I will go back and take a look at that.
Okay. And then in terms of public safety, have there been any studies in terms of access by EMT or fire to the extent there would be potentially, you know, an emergency on the trail? How would they access?
So we have, you know, the chief of police did look at the rail trail or the potential rail trail. Mm-hmm. He did talk to police chiefs in mm-hmm. surrounding areas, and he does not view it to be an issue for him.
Madam Chair, another piece of information is the fire chief is on the working group that's put together by the town to be working on this project. So he's in touch with Beals, et cetera, on that issue.
Okay. And then one final question. Thank you for the answers. One final question would be, there was mention that the way I took this is that if we don't do the rail trail now, that someone else could effectively swoop in and kind of do it their own way, and we would lose some control over how the rail trail would be done. And I'm new to town. I haven't even lived in the town for a year, so I have no dog or horse in the fight, or hound.
Or hound, right. You stole my line.
But I do live in that neighborhood that where Hunt is, and so I get it that the other access point at the center of town would be the north end, at least for the initial segment, right? Would the town have any say, in theory, at least in my view, if someone else is going to come in and do this, they're not going to do it just for that initial segment. They're going to want to do it for the connection to the other portions, the Medfield and the Needhams, right? So if that were the case, if we chose not to do it as a town and someone else were to come in and do that, would the town have any say in terms of blocking, as soon as you get to a public right-of-way, which is right in the center of town, would the town have any say to effectively say, sorry, you can do your stub from Hunt to the center of town, and you can do whatever you want to do north of there, but you're not going to run it through downtown. Is there any way that the town could effectively block that?
No. I mean, public ways are public ways, so you can't block the street crossing. If it's a private way that needs to be crossed, that's a different story. But if it's a public way, no, you can't block there. And as long as the corridor is continuous and the sufficient title rights exist in the landowner to allow someone to lease and do it, then the decision is made by other parties.
And is the rail, is it continuous the whole way through, even through the center of town, or does it, is there a public road that goes, do they intersect?
It intersects public ways along the way, okay. But the layout of the railroad is continuous. So if you walk out, whatever, near Dunkin' Donuts, and you see the tracks, they go across the street.
Right.
And when a railroad is laid out, there are accommodations made for street crossings.
Okay.
And they're there. They exist. They're part of the package that goes along with the okay. MBTA's rights.
And there is a bridge that used to cross over the Charles River going into Needham, mm-hmm. but there was some arson on that bridge, so that's condemned right now, so there's a fence up there. But the railroad used to go over the bridge and come into Dover Center.
Okay.
It's a great story if you talk to people that lived in town about 30 years ago. They would take the train from Boston to Needham Junction, then they would unhook a section of the coach and it would come through to Dover. I never experienced it, but just a small portion of the coach came into Dover Center.
And I guess just being a newbie in town, I'm having a hard time visualizing, but I guess my question is, would the town need to do anything to actually make it safe for the rail trail to connect to that part that's north of the center of town? Like, would you need to put in crossings? Would you need to put in curb cutouts? Would you need to put in crosswalks or anything like that?
Feasibility. Every question you ask is
in there. Okay.
Detail.
Yep.
So I actually,
yeah, I will check it.
I couldn't find it, so I asked that they put it right on the front.
Okay.
So there's the feasibility study right on the front, including all the exhibits.
I will admit, I haven't looked, but I will.
Right. And the other thing is, Needham just completed their rail trail. So if you have some free time on a weekend and you just go to where the Walker School is, around the corner there, I think it's Fisher Street, there's a little parking lot. And if you just walk on sections of it, you'll get a feel for what for what these rail trails are like. Right, it would be very similar.
I just want to correct something that I said on the private way, thinking about it. The rail trail is going to pre-exist and its rights are going to trump the private way in all likelihood, meaning the railroad right of way, because it had to be continuous all the way along. And if you look at the old maps, you might see private crossings on the maps, but they were laid out as part of the rail trail or the railroad, and the rights were prescribed by the law at the time that it was put in place.
Okay. Thank you.
It's just that I happened to Karen O'Sullivan, 103 Center Street. I happened to look up the issue about the parking. And in the Beals and Thomas study, it refers to that intersection that Valerie was talking about as one of the areas where there wouldn't be a problem, that there was good visibility on either side. And as she mentioned, it is actually an area where there's a lot
of
traffic.
So we'll take that under advisement and speak to Beals and Thomas.
I get your point. Thank you.
This will be a last question unless someone else comes up with something. But, and this is not for the Hunt Club, but just, you know, having been on the planning board 11 years here. The Beals and Thomas study does seem to recommend that with the Conservation Commission concurrence that you get a determination of applicability for the entire line. And the reason for that is, which you can observe without being a wetland scientist, that's really wet land. I'm just curious, has there been some discussion with the Conservation Commission? I can give you an anecdote. When I was in the planning board, after we actually had a trail approved by a developer and we were out there putting stone posts to market, the Conservation Commission at the time just lambasted us for putting basically a shovel in the ground without their permission. So I don't know what the climate now is with the Conservation Commission, but I'm curious, have you talked with them? Because you are going to be doing work, and I would think a Conservation Commission would
based on the Beals and Thomas, want a determination of applicability for all of that.
Thank you for, this is all part of the due diligence. You know, I try to make sure that I let everybody know that this is a long process, and this feasibility report spells out a lot of steps that need to be taken, and those are all, that's everything we're going to be doing. So, you know,
excellent.
It is part of the due diligence.
I think that's very important, you know, before you start, you know, you don't want the Conservation Commission sending you to conservation jail. Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you. This is it.
Okay. Sounds good. Carol Lisbon, 2 Cross Street. There are a lot of questions here tonight that are detailed implementation issues and the due diligence issues. And you've talked a lot about the Beals and Thomas report. What hasn't been mentioned at all is the Rail Trail Study Committee report, which is probably 3 or 4 times as thick as the Beals and Thomas report, and actually gets much more granular when it comes into issues of parking and various rules and regulations and so forth. There was a time when that was on the website.
I will make sure that it
should be back on the website, and I would urge everybody who's interested in the more granular discussion of some of these issues to look at that report as well.
Yeah, and I appreciate that. Everything is still on the website. It's just a little bit hard to find at times, so we will put everything in the front. Thank you. Well, I thank everybody for coming this evening. It was a little longer than I thought, but I hope everybody walked away learning something new. I certainly did. So thank you all.